His word was as good as gold.
He's really good at talking you up if you're feeling down. He's like, he always brought me up, and I get down quite a bit.
He would give you the shirt off of his back.
Nothing is impossible if you keep on it. Look at him. 72 years old, still fronting a rock band.
He puts his mind in telling you you're going to do something. That's what you do, you know. And he might not take no for an answer. He'll just keep going back.
Always makes you smile. Always.
Everything he does is balls to the wall.
I've been on the go doing something my whole life, constantly. I have goals. I've had goals all my life.
But Joel had that extra talent that most people don't have.
You saw that at an early age?
Oh, and it just kept evolving. You know, just kept evolving. He just could do it. Whatever he made his mind up to. He could do her. He'd do her well.
If you want to do it bad enough, you'll figure out a way. That's been my theory of life. Take a hobby and learn how to eat on it. And then you'll be happy.
That's what I've always observed. You know, and he's always been a caring person about people. He comes from a family that's the way that is.
My grandfather was the funeral director in Mineral City, and I had to hang around there because that's all I knew, you know. And there was only two other kids on my street, you know, and they were a couple years younger than me. My grandfather was the kind of guy that was bound determined that I was going to be an undertaker, and he used to take me with him everywhere he went. He used to take me even to the hospital. Let's say somebody died and they were going to have they called it post and an autopsy. And he'd take me along and stand me on a chair so I could see. And I remember different times the guy doing the autopsy would say, "You sure you want that kid in here?" He said, "Well, he's going to start right now. He's going to learn." So I'd have to stand there and watch autopsy. So as a result, you know, not much bothers me. It was just a completely different than anybody else I knew, you know, lifestyle. But that's what we lived. My father came home. He was in the war, Second World War, and gone. That's why I lived with my grandparents. My mother had left. It was a divorce. She was a singer. She sang some with the big bands. And that side of the family were all more musically inclined and artistic. So any artistic whatever I have came from my mother. You know, like my dad always leaned really hard on me, and he depended on me to help him. And like I said, out of respect, I did.
17, 18 years old, he was driving an ambulance for his father. You know, doing paramedic work and stuff back in the day when he didn't have no schooling, you know. He just did it because that's what he was supposed to do. That's what was expected of him, so he did it.
Tell me about a couple of the runs you guys had to make that stuck out in your head.
Oh, my. There's so many tragic things that you had to learn to not let it get to you the best you could, you know, and that's probably one of the most difficult things. People that do that kind of work, you know, has to be special people because not everybody can put their hands in a bloody mess, you know. A call came in and there was a bad accident over on the back road to Bolivar, one of those roads, ones we go on. And a car went over the bank and they didn't say too much more, and we got over there and went down over the bank, and it was a Jaguar, a really nice looking Jaguar, and it was mangled around the trees, and he got thrown out, and he got killed, the boyfriend, and the girl, his girlfriend, just a little thing, was laying there and bleeding, and she got a hold of me in a death grip. You know, she was scared to death. You could, I mean, horrified. And she was bleeding some, but I didn't know how bad she was, but she wouldn't let go. So, and we were trying to figure out how to get a cot down there to get her out of there. So I just picked her up in my arms because I wanted to get her up there to get the blood stop. Carried her up the bank, and I got to the top of the bank, and they had mowed a sign down. It had the U-type steel on, and it was like this with this, and I tripped carrying her over something and fell right on my knee. That's how I lost this knee, and it mangled it. And they said I stood up and carried her the rest of the way. I didn't even realize it, I guess on adrenaline. But I got to the hospital and they wanted to fix me up, you know. So that was, but she was just terrified. I'll never forget that look on her face. I could see it yet. But she got a hold of me, and that's not the only time that ever happened. Sometimes the first person they see, you know, that out of harm's way, they'll grasp so hard that it almost shut the blood off, you know, because they're scared, you know, you can understand. But I had so many experiences like that, and with children and stuff, you know, and wrecks and stuff, that had a lot of nightmares. And people say today, why I didn't, you know, when I got out of the, when they got out of the ambulance business, I didn't, you know, I went to the fire departments and the ambulance service people, and they take care of that. And people say, why didn't you? I said, well, I did my tour of duty. I had enough of that. I didn't choose to do that. I did that because I lived there, and that was my, out of respect, that's what I should do to help them, you know. I knew early on that I really didn't want to do that. I went to college, and like I said, I really didn't want to do that.
Didn't know what you wanted to
do? No, I didn't know what I wanted, but I had ideas of things, and then it just gradually came to me.
You know, a lot of times people don't understand why this person does this or they do that, but you know what? We're not here for everybody to understand us. We're not here for everybody to agree with us.
Well, I think the main thing is to just be yourself. To be as real as you can.
I was working a job at a place outside of Mineral called the Federal Refractories at the time, working like a dog for $1.35 an hour. Figured out real fast that that really wasn't going to be my life's work, you know. About that time, I got interested in upholstery because of my car that I had. And I went to a couple of car shows with it, and it did okay, but the one thing about it that wasn't like a lot of cars are because the upholstery wasn't done. Most of the cars there was upholstered nicely, you know, to win anything. So I had to win. So if I'm going to do it, I got to win. So I went and checked about getting interior done on it and found out that I couldn't possibly afford that. So I thought, well, the only way I could do that is to do it yourself. I called it the Snowflake because it was white. And I had it painted by a guy who lived over here in Waynesburg, or in Magnolia. He painted cars back before they had all these fancy ways they do it today to make it shine. He did it the old way, and he put 20-some coats of hand-rubbed lacquer, and it was so much depth in that white that you could look in it and comb your hair like black. It was white. Like I said, I wanted to upholster it because that was the only thing it was missing to be a real showpiece. And so I figured out how to do it by tearing it all apart. Once I had it all torn apart, I had to do something with it, you know? So you take something apart and you look at it, well, how did that go together? And figure out how to do it. Stayed up late a lot of nights, so I figured out how to do that kind of work. And once I got the gist of it, it was rather easy to me. And I won 30-some trophies with it, a lot of best of show. I taught myself to do that completely. Nobody ever showed me. And that's how the upholstery business got started. The guys would say, well, how about doing this for me? How about doing that? It just snowballed from that. It just went from people seeing my car or other cars I did, and they'd come in and say, could you do this? And I'd always said yes, and I'd figure it out. And the first sewing machine I had, a guy gave me, it was out of a, it was an old beat up treadle machine out of a shoe shop. And I figured out how to make a wooden tray on it to put the material on, because on those it just had the snout to come out and you put the shoe on it. So I had to figure out how to put a board thing in it up against a table so I could pedal that thing, you know. Then I finally made a little extra money and got another electric machine, you know. I quit the job I had, went into it full time because I had so much work, you know, it was killing me trying to do the two things. And actually I was making more on my side job than I was at the regular job, so I jumped out there and did it. And I built another building to do it in too, because I had so much, and it worked out fine. People were just starting to talk about putting the little TVs come out, you know, the little portable TVs. And I thought, boy, it'd be cool to have a TV in the trunk, you know, because they were just starting to do that. That was in the middle 60s. And I priced one of those, and it was out of the price range. So I was watching my kids playing with their toys and stuff, and I saw this object they were marking on, and I said, what the heck's that? And it was Etch-A-Sketch. Now, if you ever pick an Etch-A-Sketch up and look at it, the gray part of it kind of looks like a TV screen. So I took that piece in the back of the trunk and I cut out a hole, and I found an old beat up TV that had a framework around it, you know, the frame and the knobs and stuff. And I put that Etch-A-Sketch behind there and set it there with the the lead coming out with a set of rabbit ears, and everybody thought I had a real TV in my trunk, so I got away with it. So it worked out.
And you wanted a TV, so
I wanted
you got
a TV, you know, and everybody thought I had one then, so why should I tell them, you know? It was a showpiece.
Joel Gordon, the man with the TV, but it was really an Etch-A-Sketch.
Really was an Etch-A-Sketch. So it's out of the bag now. Years later. A lot of magazines, upholstery jobs, you know, the car would be in there and I'd get the mention for the upholstery. I wanted to win with cars. I won a lot of awards with upholstery and stuff. And I did a lot of airplanes, furniture, trucks, everything.
He'd go in there and do that upholstery work on real. Great, how he could do.
He's really got the Midas touch when it comes to like working with any kind of anything that you use a sewing machine, and anything from clothes to like car interior, furniture, phenomenal custom stuff.
Joel, you know, has to be one of the most talented individuals I ever known in my life.
Just be happy, you know, do what you want to do. And I did, you know. In a roundabout way, I didn't want to try not to make waves with the family about it.
That's just the way he is. That's the kind of person that's got drive to do anything. He's been good at everything he's ever done, upholstery, in the bands, you know, businessman. He's just incredibly talented.
If I want to do something, I'm hell-bent on doing it, and I'll figure out a way to do it.
And then Joel, of course, you know, he'd been in Velvet Crest, you know, back in the day, and so he'd toured with, like, I think he told me he had toured with Tommy James and the Shondells, and he said Tommy was pretty hazed throughout the tour, you know. He said he was pretty out of touch with reality. They just kind of shepherded him up to the stage and turned him loose, you know.
Dave played bass, and Terry played guitar, and they said I should play guitar, and I goes, oh. So I bought a guitar, a Rickenbacker, and they gave me a week to learn some songs. And I sit there with that damn thing till my fingers were bleeding and learned it. And I enjoyed it. So we started playing and we called it By Popular Demand. And we needed a drummer. So I forget which one. Anyway, this Jeff Karikas name came up, that he was a drummer from over in Magnolia. And same age, or maybe a year younger than those guys. So we got together and we had good harmony. That's what we had because everybody, all four of us sang, which was unusual at the time. But we practiced in my shop, you know, at night for a long time and went out and started playing. I think our first job was at the Avondale, which was on Tuscarawas Avenue, going towards Maslin on the right-hand side there, the Avondale. That's where we started. It went over well. It really did. We clicked right off. And that's when they kept talking about recording. That's when we went up to Cleveland Recording and did some stuff of our own. And that's when the engineer suggested we get it. He said, "Do you ever think about getting a producer so you can get this?" And I said, "Well, how do you do that?" He mentioned that he knew Carl Medeiri, and he was from the Cleveland area, and he was with different labels and stuff. And he hooked me up with him, and we had meetings, and I talked him into recording us, and of course, he picked the music. I didn't pick La Comerd Angel. We were more of a rock band, you know, type thing. And when, look, at the time that we recorded that, the music was the Vogues and all that kind of little softer music was getting a lot of airplay. So he chose La Comerd Angel. He said to me, "The name's going to be changed, and this is your manager, and we'll tell you what to do. Or we'll put this thing on the shelf and nobody will ever hear it." That's how they do that. So you sign here. So we went from By Popular Demand, which everybody knew us as when we recorded, to Velvet Crest. The thing of it is when you're young and you want to record and do things like that, Too many times I was skeptical because I was older, and it really upset them because I'd ask questions. But most of them that do that at a real young, they sign anything because all they can see is stars. You gotta be a star, who cares, you know? And they take everything you got. When it's all over, you owe them money probably, you know? And it really changed our image because we were just rock and rollers, and they made us I had to go buy velvet suits. We had gold velvet suits. To come out of a town of 850 people, and three of us lived in that town, and one from Magnolia, to get a producer to record you and get you a label was like next thing to impossible. It really is. I mean, it still is. It's probably worse. Well, it's worse then as ever. Get a producer and a company to back you and put out a record and get airplay, because you don't just get airplay. I mean, that's hard to. You got to have people that got power to do that. And luckily, we got away with that and had a half decent hit with La Comerd Angel. We were in Billboard, you know, and in Record World and different write-ups and different magazines. And it was such a new thing to us coming from a town of 850 people and never really been anywhere, so to speak. You think you are, but you're not. There's another world out there. And as we were preparing to do these shows that we're going to start doing, it came up all of a sudden that we were going to do this Mammoth show in, I didn't even say Mammoth then, it's this big show over in Pittsburgh. Since they're playing your record over in Pittsburgh, they want you on the show. And I don't even think we knew when we left here what we were walking into. I know we didn't, you know, because there was something like 12,000 people, I guess. It was an empty seat in the place. And they had a huge stage and a wall of amplifiers, which we'd never seen before, you know, for the sound. Much different than how they set up sound companies today. It's more controlled. Because I know some of our equipment Tommy Rowe used, because he didn't have something. We let him use something ours.
Tommy Rowe's?
Tommy Rowe.
Rowe.
Yeah, he had a big hit out at the time. Dizzy, I think was the name of it. Dizzy. Yeah.
My head is spinning.
I can't remember exactly, but I think that was a hit he had at the time. Tommy James and the Shondells was number one in the country. And 1 week and the next week it would be the Classics Four. They switch back and forth. And it was quite a shock to walk into a place like that and see that many people, which we never really saw the people out front till we went out actually onto the stage, because we were backstage. And Denny Yost from the Classics Four kind of introduced himself right away and showed us the ropes, so to speak, because we didn't know what we were doing. And he was a real nice guy, ended up being a kind of a personal friend for a while. Kept track of each other on the phone or something, you know. And after that show, you know, once you do that, like I say, there isn't anything to top something like that in your mind other than more of that. And we knew we wanted more of it.
So what's it like in 1969 or 68 to be on the road?
Well, in those days, we didn't have the luxury of the nice bus and stuff. You know, we toured, you know, you toured in a van or whatever you had, you know, and almost everybody did. There wasn't very many groups in those days unless they were the huge groups. They flew here or there, you know, and the road crew usually took your equipment in trucks and went on ahead and set up, and you show up and for a sound check and go back to your room and then go back and crawl on the stage. Everybody else does your work for you, you know. We were on the road up in upper New York one time. It was up in Newburgh, New York. We played up there for like a week. We went into town one day into the closest town or the closest mall. We found a mall. And Dave Bartis, which was one of the guys, decided he wanted to buy a monkey. And there was just no talking him out of it. So we went in there and we found this pet store, and they had monkeys in the window. And we went in there, and there was one guy trying to wait on all these people, you know, and these damn monkeys are in the window jumping around like a bunch of jackrabbits, you know. And we told him he wanted one of those monkeys, you know, and the guy really didn't want to do it because he needed help, you know. So he got out the big gloves, you know, put the big gloves on, because those buggers bite like crazy. They really bite. Anyway, he reached in there and got a hold of one, and finally got a hold of one and drug it out and stuck it in the cage. And when he put it in the cage, he really didn't attach it properly. So we're there at the counter to buy this monkey, and all of a sudden that cage opened up and that monkey comes straight up out of that cage, up onto the counter, terrorizing people, and got up in the ceiling. And the ceiling, they claimed, was the whole top of the mall. It's all one thing up there. So we never did find that monkey. I don't know if they ever did. So he had to go back in and get another one, because he'd already paid for it. So we had that monkey on the road, and he was funny. We used to catch him spiders, you know, and we'd roll up take a toilet paper cardboard, you know, put it inside of there. He'd pick it up, look, you know, check it out, and fisher get that spider out of there. We had him a long time on the road and brought him home, but it got loose and terrorized the town, you know. We'd looking in people's windows and go to the school and look in the windows, and the kids, you know, be unruly then. And run the wires. And there was a guy in Mineral, Paris Handy, was the town guy that fixed everything, you know? Something went wrong. Anyway, he had his truck downtown or on one of the side streets and had the doors open out and he was working on it. He had his lunch in there. Well, that monkey got in there and got his lunch bag, you know, and he tried to catch it. If he ran to the front, he'd go to the back, ran around. Finally, it stole his lunch, went up in the trees. He was pretty mad about that. But that monkey terrorized Mineral for quite a while. Then we gave it to some guy that lived on a farm, and I guess it got in a fight with an owl and lost. So that's what we heard. So that's the last I heard of Chuck. You know, he got in a fight with an owl and lost. After Look Homeward Angel did really, really well, in the middle of that, we were sold from Buddha Records or Harbor, it's one and the same. One day I got a phone call and said, you're owned now by Liberty Records in LA. And your new producer is, I believe, Dick Glasser, which it was from this area originally. And they'll be pulling the strings from now on, but you still got the same producer, because my producer had moved from Cleveland, Ohio, to Thousand Oaks in California. And so we recorded Gotta Make You Mine, which is one of our own songs. And on the other side, flip side, was Look Into the Eyes of Love. Permission to do that one, and from another group. And we recorded it actually in Cleveland, at Cleveland Recording, and they mixed it in LA at Liberty. And we went out there and spent some time, flew out there, and started out to be a couple of weeks and ended up being longer. Did a lot of record promotion, that's our, you know, up and down the coast for that record. It did fairly well too, and I don't know, can't remember exactly what happened, but in that business you just never know one day or the next. But it probably, I don't think they gave it the promotion that it should have. That's what happens if they drop the ball, you know, and don't put the money behind it. It's not going to really go anywhere, because that's just how it is. You have to get airplay all over the country. We got good airplay, but not as good as we did on Look Homeward Angel. I went in a restaurant after I got off the air. I was hungry, and we had rented a Volkswagen. I don't know, I went myself that day. All four of us were out there, but I went myself that day for some reason. And I went in this restaurant, and I was, like I said, I was hungry. And the waitress came over, and I'm thinking, oh, I'm looking at the menu, thinking, how the heck am I going to pull this off? You know, I only had so much money, and everything on the menu is like almost more money than I had. And I thought, phew. Anyway, this waitress come over, and she said, oh, I know you. She said, you're Jay Black, aren't you? I'd know you anywhere. And Jay Black was from Jay and the Americans, and I knew that. There was a couple of Jay and Americans. We even played with another one that had the name too, or bought it or whatever. Or after Jay Black quit Jay and the Americans, they hired another guy what was named Jay, which was odd. I'm trying to think of his last name, because we played with him. But anyway, she kept going on about that, you know, and she says, the manager, she went over and talked to the manager, you know, and said it was on the house. You know, all they wanted was some autographs. And I thought, yeah, hell, what the hell, you know. So I had a nice meal and signed a few Jay Black autographs and was on my way. So that's out of the bag now, too. You know, you do what you got to do when you're hungry, you know. And she's, She claimed I was Jay Black, so who was I to tell her different, you know? I was Jay Black for a day. Got a free meal. So I just ate a steak and everything, man. I was hungry. But it came to an end, like everything comes to an end. Came to an abrupt end from some bad vibes between management and us. Wasn't even me, the other guys kind of got called up the manager and got mad at, or started mouthing off against the producer because they didn't like him. And I didn't even know they did it. And here that guy recorded it and he played it to the producer. And the producer got mad and dropped it like a hot potato. So that's what happened. So I went back and went home from California. And I had a shop that I'd done upholstery in, and I decided to do something different. And I had a sewing machine. I said, I'm going to make clothes, because the big thing out in L.A., leather was coming in out there. It wasn't even much around here yet. That's when I started the Leather Loft. Just started that thing from nothing, and it became a hell of a thing.
God gives us all talents. Some does something with it and others does nothing with it. Joel's always taken those talents and took it that next level.
It's really great to see that he does what he does, because his music, his leather, it's all part of him, and just his personality overall. His heart is definitely what it's all about.
Well, I moved close to Mineral City. I bought a farm at an auction in 1972.
Okay.
And I had never heard of Joel Gordon. But I was driving around town one day and I saw this sign that caught my eye. Leather Loft with an arrow pointed down this street. So I inquired about you and they said that you did a lot of things in leather, purses and jackets and stuff like that. So one day I decided to go up to your shop, and I walked in and you had this display room. Mm-hmm. Purses and stuff in cases. And then you came out and I introduced myself and you told me who you were, and you had quite a few people working
at that time.
At that time, yeah. And I'm not sure if you was working at that time with costumes for a opera show or something.
Oh, that would be I made the costumes and designed them for Jacques Brel.
Yes.
Who's alive and well and living in Paris in New York on Broadway. Yeah, that was about 72, right?
I bought my place on June 28th of 72.
Okay.
And then I remember coming back to you, and I think the most unique thing about you that I had heard from other people, you never did the same thing twice. I took you a picture of a coat that I wanted you to make for my wife. And you told me straight off, I can make it to look summer, but I will not make it the way the picture shows it, because you have your own style of doing things.
This is a sign I was talking about inside that I saw with an arrow pointing down to his shop. And that's when I went in one day and introduced myself. And from there, that's how I got to know a little bit more about him. And then
you were intrigued.
I was very intrigued.
Because he was an offbeat character in the town, wasn't he?
Yes, he was. Everybody knew Joel. Everybody. Well, he was known all the way from here, all off the East Coast, you know.
And then his shop was out. He had one side of the garage was his leather shop. Because he used to have a place called the Leather Loft, where he made nothing but custom leather clothes. And it was nonstop. And back in the day, like guys that were racing motorcycles, like racing flat track and stuff, he would make them like full leather suits, jackets, pants, stuff for girls.
Well, in the time, I think back in the 70s, it was like a cool thing. Everybody wanted it. And to have somebody right there that could do it was amazing. They did. They came from New York and, I mean, all over, Akron, Cleveland. They just came locally and out of state, and they just gravitated because they knew that he could make it to fit them. And he would do a specialty. Whatever it is they wanted, he'd make sure that it was what they wanted.
And he wasn't satisfied with just being as somebody else was, but he wanted to be the best that he could be. And I'd really say he wanted to be better than he could be or anybody else could, and he proved it. Through the years, he proved it.
The idea was I wanted to make custom things. I like things, when I buy clothes, it's always, I go to get it, it's too baggy here, or something's wrong with it, you know, and I don't like that. And I figure other people don't either. You know, you go to the store and buy a, say you're gonna buy a coat, say you're gonna buy a leather coat. You buy that coat, the closest thing you can get to fit you, that the arms are the right length and the length of it's right. It might be a little baggy here, but that's how it is, you know. Maybe you would rather have it. So I never tried to make too many on the rack type things, only as samples. And I would make those in my size. In case somebody didn't buy it, maybe I'd get a coat that way. And I'd have people come in, they could come to my shop, and I'd sit down with them and talk to them about what they liked, what they didn't like about, and I'd say, well, how do you want this coat? Well, I don't really know, but, you know, I don't want the sleeves to touch me down here on my hand, and I like it a little more snug, and, you know, and I'd see what they didn't like, and then I could design that coat to their liking. And then I'd sit there and sketch it while they were talking about what they didn't like. And I said, is this what you're talking? Oh, yeah, that's it. Usually it worked. So then I would just measure them specifically for that coat, you know, the way they wanted it to fit and the length they wanted. And if you think about this, if I made over 6,000 coats, and I did, how many times can you change this in here and be different? So that was a challenge for me, to see how many different ways I could make the coat look, you know. At first, I had, I worked myself, but Dave Bartis was with me in the band in Velvet Crest, and he hung around the shop, so I kind of put him to work cutting fringe. Fringe was in when I started around 70. Converted my shop, my upholstery shop, petitioned it off and made it into showrooms and started making stuff and putting in there and got the word out and people started coming around and they came there and ended up from even tour bus, they bring busloads in. And it did really well. That's when I had to hunt a leather source. So I got in the phone book and called information to different cities trying to find leather companies, acting like I was looking for a leather company. And they'd tell me whether there's one there or not. And I hit Milwaukee, Wisconsin. It was a big leather thing there called General Split. And I started out with a split leather, you know, the rough on both sides. And that was the big thing at the time. Anyway, I took stuff up there that I had made out of their leather. And Mr. Levine was the name of the guy that run the place. He just thought it was unreal, you know. And he said, they're having a leather show in New York City, which I didn't understand at the time what it really was. But he said, I'd like you to go and take these things and we'll set you up in a booth and you can show the buyers that come in there for leather what can be done with it, because we've never really done that other than just draped hides. So I want people to see what can be made out of those hides. We've never done that. So I said, fine. So he paid the way, you know. People came through and looked at it and got a lot of comments, and they said, well, we're having a showing, you know, in front of the public on the runway with an agency, and they wanted to show my stuff. I didn't realize at the time that it was actually for a prize, you know, or whatever. And I even went home, and they contacted me and told me I had won the top award, international leather designer in the world, you know, and I had no idea I was in competition. So that's how I won that first award. I went twice, two different years, just for the heck of it, and I won both times, so I really didn't try it again. From that, I was contacted to costume. Jacques Brel was alive and well and living in Paris in New York, and they flew me in to that. And I stayed there and saw the production of it in rehearsals, and went home and started designing the stuff on the plane on the way back, because I didn't have a lot of time either, because I was super busy in my shop, and I had to hurry up and get them done because they needed them. So they wrote me up in Boutique magazine after that, and pictured my stuff on the centerfold in Boutique, which opened a lot of doors for stars. Different people called me to, I made stuff and shipped out all over.
But the store was well received in Mineral City.
Well, a lot of people in Mineral didn't really know what I did up there in the alley, you know. It was funny, I had more people from out of town coming there constantly than the people in Mineral really didn't. A lot of them didn't know what I did up there, because they would come in when they wanted, needed a, taken up a collection for something, and I would hear the older lady say, well, I didn't know that, look, he's got purses and everything in here. It'd been there for years, you know, but they'd go to Canton to shop, maybe, you know.
I'm telling you, and he made some beautiful clothing. Absolutely beautiful. And if he had moved away out of our town, he would have made a lifelong career out of just leather dressing.
She came to me out of high school, stopped in there one time on a bicycle ride, and stopped in the shop and was intrigued by it, and kept coming back around, and I hired her. And I taught her to cut leather.
I mean, I'd go there and we'd make our coffee and put in the reel-to-reel, listen to music all day, and the leather work, he was busy, and we'd make sure that everything was going right, and actually people would come in and he'd measure them, and I don't know how I knew how to do what I did, but it just came natural, and he'd be at one side sewing, I'd be at the other side cutting, and we'd listen to music and laugh, and
we connected and taught you how to cut, you know, we could really, it was a teamwork. And if I'd had to cut it and sew it too, I couldn't have done a third of what I was able to produce.
From what he did on paper, I'd make it work on the leather, and then somehow it came together.
Right. Well, you were the only one that I could have done it. Nobody else could have done what you did, you know, because...
You guys were made for each other.
Well, I could see his visions, I guess. That's it. I knew what he wanted, and I knew how to get it.
You know, if I cut it, it was sloppy, because you didn't see it. When she cut it, it was like perfect, you know. It's like, geez.
Well, that's what he always said. Well...
Perfectionist also. She would cut it so perfect, it was easy to put together.
Every once in a while, I'd crowd him out, though, and he'd remind me. My leather would get in his way when he's sewing, so, you know. It was
how
just kind
of... How would he put that? Get your shit out of my way?
No, he was real diplomatic about it. I'll never forget it. Because I was working away, cutting, and, of course, the hides are huge. And we shared the same table, although it's large, and he's on the opposite side. And I'm cutting away. Well, my hide got down a little too close to his sewing machine, and I'm cutting, and he just looked at me. He goes, am I crowding you? And I just looked at him, oh, you know, I was into my own thing too. So, you know, I mean, we just always got along. It was just like a great, great feeling to work and do things that you like to do.
I don't think I ever remember sitting there waiting on you to ever to get something done to keep me going. She always had me, I better get the hell on the move here. She's going to run over me. So.
I don't know how to explain it. It was just a fun job. I loved it. He went to New Mexico and had friends out there, and he'd bring back Indian jewelry. All the things that I liked were things that were a part of him.
Tell me about going to New Mexico with clothes.
Yeah, they had me to New Mexico. I had met through a guy I bought some jewelry from my shop. He said he had some friends in New Mexico that made jewelry, and he'd like me to meet those people. And he was going to talk with them, show them some of my stuff about the shop, you know, and found out that they were interested in what I did, too, and invited me out to their place in New Mexico if I would come, and they would have a big showing of my clothes out there. And I thought, well, it's a new market, you know, another opportunity to show my stuff in a completely different market. So I flew to New Mexico, flew into Albuquerque, and then traveled north. They lived in Los Alamos. And their name was Fred and Teresa Cornwell. And Fred was a scientist. He made jewelry, but he was a scientist up at the lab, up at Los Alamos Lab. But we had the showing down at their place, and all kinds of people came from all over. And a lot of Indians came, different Indians. Blue Corn was there with her son Joseph, and Blue Corn is the most famous Indian potter in the world at this time, if she's still living. And when I visited San Ildefonso is the village, and I have a piece of my clothing with beaded in different things, silver and heishi and turquoise and stuff in that museum. But like I said, I've had the opportunity to meet a lot of different kind of people this way.
So you were a guest at Blue Corn's house?
Home. And I was probably walking around on just priceless Indian rugs and a piece of her pottery. And she wanted to trade me some pottery for leather, which I was a fool not to do now, which I kick myself ever since. But a piece of her pottery that probably fit on the end of your finger now, it's probably worth thousands. Can you imagine what the other ones are worth?
What was the strangest request, leather making request that you've had?
Well, I had a pathologist out of Columbus came, an older guy, with his, I thought it was his daughter, but actually it was his chick, you know. Maybe on the side, who knows? I never ask. And he came to me one Sunday. They were there, and he opened his coat and pulled this pamphlet out, you know, and looked around, see if anybody's looking, and unfolded it and said, "Can you make one of these?" You know, it was out of one of those skin magazines, you know, and it was a real skimpy thing, you know, the boobs hanging about mostly out, you know, and the bottom had, you know. Would be like a thong today, you know, type thing. You know, he wanted out of deer skin. And I said, Well, you know, anything could be done, you know. So I made it. Fitting was nice too. Oh boy.
That was a fun fitting, huh?
Oh yeah. Oh yeah, you get some strange requests. I'm sure there were plenty more, I just can't think of them, but that one there stuck in my mind. Because the guy just looked like the last person that would come up with something like that in a line of people that you would pick. So you never know. I phased Leather Loft out probably around 1983 because the EPA stepped in and put a lot of these leather companies out of business. They got so that the prices, the quality dropped, and I got so that I wouldn't put my name on a piece of crap, you know. If I didn't believe in the leather to begin with, I wasn't going to use it, and I didn't.
Well, you know, anybody that does less than the best they can do, and he never did. He always done the best he could do and reached for the higher.
It was just an amazing time in my life.
How many years?
Oh, I worked there for nine, almost 10 years. I guess I did work 10. The last couple were just part-time. The leather industry kind of went down and things were changing.
So I walked away from that for a while and went back to music.
When's the first time you remember going to see American Grease?
Well, I remember they opened for Gary Lewis and the Playboys at Dover High School. And that was probably back in 94, 95. And actually, Darren used to be our paper boy growing up. So all of us girls had a crush on him, okay? So I told my sister, Nina, oh my gosh, you gotta go hear this band. And I had tickets to go back. I had 4 tickets, and my sister Nina and I went back for the second show. They did a 2-show gig, and I went to the first one, and I noticed Darren. And I'm like, that's Darren. So I told my sister, and we went back for the second show. And from that time on, I just started hanging with them. I mean, it was awesome.
First time I went to see him was in Coshocton. We had just moved across the alley from him, and we had met, and I went down, and I remember sitting at a table off to the side from everybody else. And I remember seeing Tina up there with someone else dancing and wondered, you know, who she was. And that's when Joel slid that CD across the floor at me. And that's when I first started really getting excited about the band. I was just in total awe watching him sing.
Yeah, whenever the band first got together, I was living next door to Joel, and we carried all the lights and them speakers, you know, the ones that were about 500 pounds a piece. Two guys trying to carry him around. Joel's one of them and weighs about 110 pounds soaking wet. And lights and all that stuff. Yeah, thought we were real rock stars back in the day.
The first time I seen him walk in, I was like, whoa, check this guy out. He's awesome. He had the hair down and he had like a ponytail up here and the hair was down and had a jean jacket on. It was the first Friday. And I was sitting with my mom and my fiance, you know, Carrie and Angela, and we were all like amazed. We're like, okay, one of us has to talk to him. So then I found out that he plays Pat.
And it's fun, you know, to sit in the back and watch how people approach him. And it gives me a sense of pride when they like what he does and they make a push to get to the stage, or, you know, they grab him afterwards or whatever. I love nothing better than sitting back watching that, because I'm like, yep, you're finding out what I know. What a great person he is.
I always try to get off the stage and go right straight to those people to let them know that you noticed, you know, and glad they're having a good, make sure they're having a good time, and giving away a lot of tambourines and stuff to people that...
Well, in a case of that, just recently he went to Stack Hair, and the doctor is from Pennsylvania. and she recognized him right away. And here, years and years ago, she had been with her grandmother at a show, and he gave a tambourine to her grandmother. And this woman cherished it till the day she died. And this woman remembered that.
I ran into her, isn't that ironic?
And then to run into her in a little town like Carrollton, Ohio.
It was in York, Pennsylvania. Mm-hmm. She sat two seats down from the lady that I gave the tambourine to, and she remembered me. Mm-hmm. I said, how do you remember me that? She said, well, that's hair, you know, you can't.
Because I asked him, I said, who's the guy with the black hair, with all that black hair? He says, I know that guy, I'll introduce you. So from the minute I walked over and met him, I just loved him immediately. Just immediately, I did. We hit it off, just boom. And when you go to see him play, he never lets you go unnoticed. He right. always acknowledges that you're there,
yep.
appreciates his fans that keep coming back.
It was odd forming, it really was, and it went from one thing into another, and then I started more or less taking over because they wasn't working, and got these guys together. They're none of us are in it now. And we played a few jobs around Dover, New Philly. And then three of them, their love was heavy metal. You know, they're good friends of mine. And they got a chance to do something with a big radio station. We were booked to play up in Sandusky. And we were at the gig, and they got a call, these three guys, to do their show. And it left me short at the job for the next night. And I got on the phone, because one of the other guys that was left in it would have been Dan Harmon. He called, he knew Jim Bresnik. He called Jim Bresnik on the spot, and we need a drummer too. His friend was Mike Briel, and they drove up there, and we put a gig together, sitting in a motel room, set by set, and it was formed right there on the spot, and it stuck for a long time, you know, and then Dan got out of it, and I took on different ones till it formed into finally with Bones and Jim and, you know, the guys that are mostly there now.
I actually started playing in American Grease in 88 or 89. I think they started 87.
And when did you guys run into me at the recording studio I was engineering?
We were doing a recording at in Canton, at CMC.
You guys showed up at the recording studio and there I was.
He was the engineer and I didn't even know he played a guitar. Well, we were putting it all together the way you piece them, and Jim had one guitar, Jim was a lead guitar player, and he had one solo that he hadn't done and was holding up the project, and he was in a truck out on the road, you know. And Bones just said, well, I'll do it for him. And I'm thinking, at the time, I didn't even know you play guitar, you know. And he said, yeah, I can do it. So he was sitting there at the console. And he went out, it was in a music store, it was in the front. So he went out and got a guitar, come back and plugged it right in the board, you know. And he run the tape through and burned in a solo, and I thought, holy Christ, you know, and I knew right then and there, I want that guy. And he was playing in a country band at the time, and I hounded him till I got him, and he's been there ever since. And him and Jim are both lead guitar players, and they play off each other so well, because they knew each other from before and playing since they were young.
Yeah, him and I are on the road for a long time. We went on the road in a music explosion, originally.
1970.
You remember, they had a band called Little Bit of Soul. Yeah. And we played in that band for a while, so.
And they complement each other a lot of times it's hard to have two guitar players because guitar players are a breed of their own, and it's funny how if it works, it works, and some of them can't work together because it's just strange. But those two can work together.
I met his sons first, Randy and Jeff, and but then when I met Joel, he asked me if I would run sound for his 50s, 60s tribute band, and I did for about a year.
Yeah, Darren was running sound for us, and I got rid of one of them one night, got mad about too much drinking, and I pulled, and he used to come up and sing a couple songs with us, and he had a hell of a good voice, you know. So he was running sound, and we were playing at Bentley's in New Philly, and I drug him off the soundboard up on the stage.
And then some member changes occurred and things like that, and there was a spot that opened up on stage, and he also knew me from another band, because I remember that he'd actually seen my other band play before. He said, well, you sing songs, you're up. So we subbed a guy to run sound while I went up on stage and started doing a few tunes with him, and the rest is history.
One would quit, or you had to get rid of somebody, or whatever. You have got to always, so there was never any downtime for hardly at all. I had somebody, you have to have somebody in mind for drums, for keyboards, for everything.
Said he was looking for a bass player, so I said, sure, I'd be interested. So he sent me the information, some of the songs that were being played and so on, and the brochure, I think it was in the package also.
I remember that.
And yes, and I went down, came to a rehearsal, and heard the guys sing, and I was just thoroughly amazed by the talent in the band, so I figured I can't pass that up. So that was in 94,
yep,
and was with the band till about, what, 2002 or something like that? Quite an experience.
Yep, you were part of the, in my opinion, the greatest time slot for this band.
Oh, we had a good thing going, didn't we?
It was at its peak. Everybody was on the top of their game. I mean, we turned it into an actual show. It wasn't just, you know, five or six guys up there playing music. It was a show.
Let's see. So I hooked up with them guys in 95 or 96. And like I said, it was right when things were starting to take off. And they were playing a lot of festivals and fairs and not so much bars or clubs. I mean, still played in clubs and stuff, but a lot of opening gigs for America and who else? REO Speedwagon, 38 Special, Creedence, I'm trying to think, Grassroots.
David Lee Roth and Sammy Hagar, all, you know, the Rat.
You know, a bunch of bands like that, classic rock bands that were pretty big and stuff. So we was doing a lot of big shows. I remember one summer we played, I think, 10 or 12 weekends on Kelly's Island. And that was a lot of fun. And so it was like a brotherhood, you know, and Joel was the leader. He was the one doing the most work, for sure, because me, I like to play, and so did them guys, but not so much the legwork of it.
I always tried to make the right decision. Maybe I didn't make them all right, but I sure tried with everybody's good, you know, at heart for the better of everybody.
He took care of all the business. Like, he's like a mother figure to all us guys. You know, he organized, he took care of everything. Well, yeah, but we all had to be kind of led around, and, you know, he's the only one that held it together, actually, you know, as far as...
Yeah, he was like the glue.
Yeah.
Still is.
Because nobody, you know, nobody else had that incentive.
I guess I just had the knack to know how to handle them, you know. The glue, they called me the glue that kept the thing together.
I'm the roadie, I'm a lead singer, I'm the manager of this band, I'm the booking agent, I do their laundry, I make sure they're dressed right.
Yeah, he does.
He pretty much does it all.
You know, we always had to be taken by the reins and guided around, you know, and tell us what to do, and our job just show up and play. you know, but all the in between and stuff, you know, he took care of all that. We never, it was a business, you know, just had to run like a business, so.
Yeah, he even cleaned Darren up and made him look presentable.
Yeah.
Don't tell him I said that.
Oh, he'd buy, we'd wear suits, we'd wear, you know, he'd get all that stuff, you know, all the clothes.
I'd watch and see what they're putting on and say, no, that ain't gonna work. Stripes and plaid does not go together. Stuff like that, because they'll admit it too. They would admit it. I usually had to holler. Not always, but a lot of times I'd strongly suggest, I don't think you ought to wear that out there. You know, I was like the father, because I was always older than all of them, at least 10 years. Some of the guys in the band early on there, or a few years ago, were in their 20s. Like Pat, he's in his 20s, you know, and I was in my 60s. And we get along fine.
I think I was 21. So I was 21, and, you know, outside of that band, the biggest band I had been in was a band called The Gnomes, and we played out about 5 times a week. And it was a good gig, and right before that, too, I was in a country band called Southern Heart, and we played out about 5 times a week, but we played out 5 times a week in bars that half the time you're like, why am I in this bar? I don't belong in this bar. This is way beneath what I'm able to do. And by getting in a band with, like, American Grease, it really makes a difference. You know, you all of a sudden you have this confidence because you're with other guys that have been doing it for as long as they, I mean, I think they started that band in 87, so I was 3 years old when that band was started. And those guys had the confidence, and it just rubs right off on you.
I'm more of a ballad singer than I am a, you know, with the one to the meat to it.
And I just would sit and watch him. I mean, he was just, you know, he just pulled you in, you know, and I was just so amazed.
The first gig that we did up on Kelly's Island with me and the band was for, it was 3 days, Friday night, 2 shows on Saturday and a show on Sunday, and then we'd come home. And we got done on Friday night, and it was Joel's birthday. And so we get done, and we're out of this place called East Bay, which is like on the east side of the island, or West Bay, I'm sorry, West Bay. And uptown, there's a couple other bars. So we headed up there after the gig, and Joel got up there before we did, and I went up there with Brez. Jim Bresnik was in American Grease. And I said, well, where are we going? He said, we're going to this place called the Casino. He said, Joel likes to hang out there, you know. So we go rolling in this place, and I'm like, wow, there's all these people like crowded around this dance floor. I'm like, I wonder where Joel's at, you know? And he's like, oh, I don't know. And I said, well, I wonder what all these people are looking at here, you know? So, you know, we get our way through the crowd up here. Well, here Joel's already up there, you know, and he's had a few drinks, okay? Him and some girl are the center of attention here. The whole place is wrapped around them on the dance floor. And Joel is like on the dance floor doing like all of his Jagger impressions and boogie, you know? And the whole place is like literally just wrapped around the dance floor watching Joel, you know, and he's putting on all of his Travoltas and all these, you know, moves, you know, as he's drinking and stuff. And that was my introduction, you know, to the nightlife at Kelly's Island.
And got a chance to be get a taste of what being a rock star was like, being on a tour bus, traveling the country, getting to see some different places. It was very interesting, very satisfying. I very much enjoyed it.
We were sitting up at Cedar Point there at Shooters that one time, and we were sitting in George Michael's tour bus. And I can remember just like it was yesterday, he says, you know, Brez, he goes, we're going to have one of these buses someday. There it is.
It was a Silver Eagle, and it was Johnny Paycheck's old bus is what we had. Went clear down there to below Nashville. Drove it home. Oh my God, was it a mess. But it took a while to get that thing back in shape. But when I got done with it, I went all over it. It looked like $1 million.
Johnny Paycheck's bus had the old violin in the same spot that we wanted to put our logo. So we sanded that off and you know, buffed it down, and I put the logo on the bus.
We were lucky with Grease. We played from Minot, North Dakota, to clear down around to Florida and up the East Coast.
We were this close many times of breaking to the next level. I mean, every musician that works to a point to get to the upper levels where you're playing bigger venues for more money and more people and more exposure, you're really close. I mean, you're only a step below national artists. The only difference between them and you is that they have a record contract.
The times that we had, money could not buy.
A lot of times I think, you know, and there were six guys in Grease and a sound guy, you know, and a lot of expenses with a bus and all this. And I, you know, sometimes at gigs, I think Joel, you know, was basically paying us and he wasn't making nothing. I mean, he might have made a little bit, but there was times when he just likes playing so much that, because, you know, he's thinking, oh, these guys got bills and stuff, so do I, but, you know, and he'd kind of doled out, and because I'd be kind of like, well, Joel, you know, how about, and he'd be like, oh, it's all good. You know, I'm cool. It's all cool. I'm fine. Don't worry about it.
The truth be known, as a musician, you would do it for nothing for that feel if you could afford it. A real true musician, it's not about the money. It's about how you touch these people. And when you look out into their eyes when you're doing this, you can tell. You get so you can tell from the look in their face and their eyes if you're getting to them or not. And that's especially if you're doing a ballad type thing, that really you can just, that's why you do it. That's the only thing I can say. It's just hard to explain.
He was there to play and have fun when he was doing it, and he really looked forward to, you know, doing gigs and stuff, you know. Whereas I played with a lot of musicians that are really good players, but they kind of got that jaded musician thing going on, like, eh, you know, another gig, and I'd rather be home playing Xbox or whatever. You know, that's how some of these guys get. Well, not him, man. He's like, you know, yeah, we're going to jam tonight, you know, and he's still that way, you know, at 72 years old.
Musicians are worse than drug addicts because they can cure drug addicts, but you can't cure a musician.
So true. You can't you have cure to do music. It. You cannot cure music.
I mean, everybody likes Joel. My mom loves Joel. All my girlfriends I've had are just like crazy about Joel, you know. He's one of them people that never met a stranger. You know that. You guys are friends with him now, you know. That's in 100 more, you know, and on you go. And then he's, you know, and plus in the face of a lot of adversity, I don't know if he's told you that he lost both of his boys.
I have in the last few years tragically lost both my sons to accidents. And it changed my perspective of life all over again. Anyone that has lost kids knows what I'm talking about. My boys were ornery boys, but they were lovable boys, and they took an interest in everything I ever did. Jeff, my youngest, I bought him a sewing machine for his 13th birthday. He would come out and watch me, and he could do anything I could do if he wanted to. He used to come home from school and sew purses for me. Randy, he couldn't settle down long enough to, I'm sure he had the ability, they all had artistic ability, all three of my kids had artistic ability. They just didn't pursue it, you know.
Like you.
Like me, you know. They had other things in mind. Jeff, he liked to go out in nature, mess around, you know. He was having a rough time at home, and he had a lot of, he was a very depressed type person, and went through a lot with his marriage and it went sour, so he was down to see me this one Sunday and had one of his kids with him. He had a couple of kids that were really close to him, and they were close with him, and he had them with him and was having problems, and we were talking, and I told him to come back the next day. We had to work something out. You got to get the kids home, and you get back here tomorrow, and we'll work it out. So tomorrow came, and he never showed up, which I never thought too much about it, because I thought, oh, he'll be here when he gets around to it. He's probably working or something. A couple of days went by, nothing. And by the third day, I was making calls, and nobody could find him. So I was pretty frantic. So I started looking for him, backtracking, looking, and nobody had seen him. And I ran into Nan on the fifth day. I had been to the sheriff's office. I'd been everywhere. And they were trying to help me look for him. And Nan was with me, my friend, and she said, yeah, almost the same time I did, how about Tunnel Hill? That's a place outside of Mineral that the kids used to go. A train tunnel was there at one time, and the train went through there. Well, it collapsed over the years. But the kids would go out there and party, you know. I thought, well, maybe down around Tunnel Hill someplace, because the kids always went there, you know. So I went out there and didn't see anything there and went on up on the top of the hill. And by the time I got up there, the sheriff pulled in, and he said, what are you doing here? And I said, well, what are you doing here? He said, we got a call from the lineman that the lines go through there, the high tension wires, you know, and they clear a space for that, you know, for the big towers they put in for the power to go over through the country. And there's on that hill, they have that. And he said, well, we got a report that there was a pickup truck there, and that's what Jeff had, was a pickup truck. And I started down over the hill, and I saw his truck, and not him. And to be honest, my knees buckled, because I, in my mind, I knew. But they wouldn't let me go down there, and they sent me home. By the time I got home, another friend of mine lives in that area. He had found him. He had fallen, got stuck with that truck down in there, and must have got out of the thing because the door was even open. And they figure he fell and hit his head on a rock, and it must have knocked him unconscious, and he froze to death. And he was out there all them days, you know. Randy had a job and was working up around Ashtabula, and he stopped at the house, and he had just bought a beater, as they called him, rig ride, from his aunt. And I said, Randy, those tires look terrible in that car. They're dry rotted. They're not going to last. I wouldn't drive around a block in that thing. And he said, yeah, I know, Dad, but I think I can make them last till I get paid, and I want to get new ones before I come home. I said, well, you make sure you do. Be careful. Just take your time. So he went up there and went to work and a few days. And I got the call about 2-3 o'clock in the morning that there had been an accident. Evidently a tire blew. He hit a tree and it caught on fire. They couldn't get him out. So that's how I lost him. So
how do you deal with something like that?
Well, I can't really. I don't talk about this much, but I can't. there's no formula to deal with something like this other than time makes it tolerable. You never get over it. Never. She was there for me when my first son died. Her and I were together looking for him, and I'll never forget that.
Me either. And it was hard. I've lost two.
Oh, my.
Yeah, but...
And she was there for me through that. I think he even took off work, and you were just there at my side through that whole thing. I'll never forget what you said when we come home from the calling hours for Randy or for Jeff. We were sitting there and somebody must have questioned your closeness to me. And she stood up and said, I'd take a bullet for this guy. I'll never forget that.
So it was just one person sort of
doing this? I don't know what happened, but somebody said something.
I can't even recall who the person was or why. I remember doing it, but it was just me in my mind because I believe in standing up for yourself and what's right. I don't remember, actually.
And you actually stood up and what did you say?
I said I would take a bullet for him.
I was really having trouble with my first son's death, and I never really could, deal with it.
He never took time to really grieve and to get through that process.
And I had no book.
And I made him. Because you have to get through and to move on, you have to deal with it. And he was stifled. He had nowhere to go, no one to talk to about it. And so I made him.
It shakes your faith to a degree for a while. He never gives you more than you can handle. Sometimes you wonder what else, you know, you hate to even say it.
He bounces back from that stuff, and I know it shook him up pretty hard. You know, we talked about it, but.
I just try to remember the good, and I have my daughter left. Of my three kids, and so life goes on. We just try to get through it the best we can.
I laugh and say, I've been knocked down, kicked on, and stomped, but my ass ain't been beat yet. Why? Because you don't give up. That's the way Joel is. He's been knocked down, and knocked down, but you know what? He don't stay down. You don't stay down. He always comes back up.
He's been through hell and back, and then back again, and then back again. If I could be half the man that man is whenever I die, I'll take it.
I'm just going to keep going as long as I can go.
And music being...
Music.
Being that one that helps you along.
That music really helps. It does. For that length of time you're doing it, you don't even really notice all those things. They're there, but it's not as bad.
I got to go on. He said music's the only thing that I even care about, really, you know, throwing my heart into, because it's always give me something back.
And I've found that doing music is my therapy. And it's something I love to do inside of me. And it's something that's just helped me cope. Gives me something to look forward to, of a gig coming up, no matter where it is or what it is, at least you're doing that thing that makes you tick.
And how you guys feel about playing still right now?
Love it. Completely. My blood cells have little flag, musical note flags on them. It runs through our veins, definitely.
Absolutely.
Most of the time we eat, sleep, and drink music, don't we?
Yeah. Music is a gift. You're born into it. You have to do it. It's almost like an addiction.
you know, hopefully you find something in life when you're young that you can do for make decent money or a living at, and you don't mind getting up in the morning and going and doing it.
All these things he did were things that were unique and different and that he liked doing. So life's a lot easier, treats you a lot better, you know, if you're doing something you like every day instead of like, you know, punching a time card somewhere and you hate it. Well, I'm giving up 40, 50 hours a week of my life to have, you know, a nice car and a house or whatever, but I'm hating this third of my life, you know. And he told me, you know, don't fall into that trap. Just do what you're doing. If you like playing drums, then that's what you need to do and figure out a way to make that work for you. Just like he was good at sewing and this stuff, and he figured out a way and put the leather loft together, and it started small and it snowballed, and pretty soon, man, he had that business there was a big success. That was a jamming business. Joel was really on top when that was going on, when he's making them leather clothes. And that started, you know, in his garage, basically, you know, in his house, you know, and him doing something that he had a talent for and that he liked to do. Same way with the music thing, you know, and he's still out here, you know, doing that. So that was one of the big things I took from Joel was, you know, it's possible to do what you want to do.
You know, God gives you things. He gives them to you. What you do with them's up to you.
Too many people get up in the morning and go to work and hate every minute. You hear people growling about going to work, can't wait to get off and go do something else. Well, I never tried to live that way. I tried to pick that hobby and learn how to eat on it for a while. So I was lucky that way to be able to get away with that from sheer determination. Sheer determination of wanting to do my own thing. I sing or I sew. That's me.